Let's talk about DHCP failover. If you don't know about it or you are curious and you want to learn more, this might be an interesting video as I will be going over some of the concepts that have to do with DHCP failover. In this video, we will not do any configuration, it will just be theory. So, to start, DHCP failover appeared in Windows Server 2002, so it was a new feature at that time. With DHCP failover, as the name suggests, you can ensure that you have a continuous availability solution for your DHCP service. And a basic idea of how it works, you have two DHCP servers, and when you configure them in a failover relationship, then they will share the list information and scope settings. And of course, in case one of them fails, then the other one will take over the load. So you will always have DHCP available to your clients. I want also to show you very quickly the previous ways of obtaining high availability for DHCP. One of them was to have a failover cluster of DHCP servers, which works, but of course it's a little more complex since you are dealing with shared storage and cluster nodes. The other way was to use split scope, meaning that you would have maybe two servers in one location, and you would configure two scopes from an IP range, its scope with a different subset of IP addresses from that range. But the two servers did not know about each other, so they would operate independently. Enter DHCP failover. It uses a DHCP failover relationship to replicate one or more scopes between two servers. A DHCP server can have failover relationships with more than one server, but very importantly, a scope can only be part of one relationship. So maybe you could have four servers, in which one server can have a relationship with the other three. Maybe you have on one of them three scopes, and on the other three each with one scope, and you have three different relationships. And, as a note, a DHCP server can have maximum 31 relationships on it configured. Failover has two modes of operation. First is hot standby mode, in which one server responds to all DHCP requests from the clients, and the other one waits in standby mode. If for some reason the active server does not respond or becomes inactive, then after a set amount of time, the standby server takes over servicing the clients. The second mode of operation is load balance mode. In this mode, both servers are active at the same time and they respond to client requests. You configure a percentage of IP addresses that is assigned to each server, which by default is 50-50. So you are sure that each server has a different range of IP addresses to give out to clients. And if one of the servers goes down, after an amount of time, the other server will have 100% of the range given to it, so we can respond to all clients. So let's see a more graphical representation of how DHCP failover works. Let's talk first about load balance mode. So we start first with a DHCP server, a normal DHCP server with a scope configured and with a start and end IP address. And we have DHCP 02, which only has the role on it, no scopes, nothing. When we want to configure failover between these two servers, we have to create a relationship that contains this scope. So let's say this is the relationship, and now because we have a load balance relationship, the DHCP scope and its settings will be also set on the other server. And now, because they operate in load balance mode, we have to set, or we leave the default, but there will be a percentage of IP addresses that each server can give out. Let's say that we have 50-50, which means that for this server, it will only be able to use the IP addresses that are not with red, and for this one, it will be the other way around. So each server knows what IP addresses to give to clients, everything is okay. And the failover relationship takes care that the servers communicate each time when they hand out a new list to a client. Now, let's say that on the first server, DHCP goes down, not available anymore. Because this relationship is a continuous communication between the two servers, the second server will see that this one is down, and it will enter a mode that is called communications interrupted. So let's write here. Now this server is in communications interrupted mode. What happens in this mode? Now a timer starts, which is called the state switchover time, in which this server waits because maybe the 01 server might come back up again. It continues to serve its clients with its range of IP addresses, but it does not yet take control of the full scope. Now, after that time has passed, it will enter another state, which is called partner down state. Now in the partner down state, another timer comes up, which is called the maximum client lead time. And after this time has passed, then the server will assume that DHCP 01 will not come back anytime soon, and it will take over all the addresses. This will hand to clients all addresses of the scope. If at some point DHCP 01 does come back, then the 02 will replicate all the new information to it, and then they will resume 50-50 or whatever was the percentage. Okay, so now let's talk about the hot standby mode. In hot standby mode, let's say we begin again from a DHCP server that has the scope configured on it, and a DHCP 2 that only has DHCP installed as a role. Again, we have to create a relationship between the two servers. Only this time, this will be a hot standby mode relationship. So what does it mean? Firstly, again, the scope and the settings will be copied to the second server. Okay, the DHCP scope. But it will not get any IPs because in this mode, DHCP01, since it's the server that we created the relationship on, will be active. And DHCP2 will be standby. Okay. The only thing that we need to configure is that on the active node, we have to keep a small percentage of IPs reserved in case it goes down, that the standby node has to service the clients while in the intermediary states before it becomes active. Meaning that, let's say maybe we reserve 5% or whatever this is. So the last couple of IPs from this scope will not be available to the active server to give out to clients. Okay, so let's say that now 01 again becomes inactive for some reason. Then what happens? Because of the relationship of the and the continuous communication between the two servers, O2 will enter again in the communication interrupted state. Now, while it's in this state, it will be granted the possibility to hand out the small percentage of IPs. So let's say only this, and the rest of them are not available yet to it. When it enters this state, again, a timer starts counting, the switchover timer, and when it gets to zero, then the server will change the state to partner down state. Now when it's in partner down, it's the same story, and another timer comes up, the maximum client lead time, and after this timer gets to zero, then it happens. It will get the full scope. And it's active. In case this server will start responding again, then the two DHCP servers will communicate, will receive all the new information, and when it's safe, this will become again the active node and this the standby node. So as you saw, there were two, in my opinion, two important terms that we went over, which are the two timers. The maximum client lead time and the state switchover interval. Whenever one of the servers in a failover relationship goes down, when the other server sees this, it will mark the communication as interrupted and it will start the state switchover interval timer. When this timer is zero, then the communication will be marked as partner down and the maximum client lead time will start counting. At the same time, any list that is given during this time will be given with the maximum client lead time and not with the time set on the scope. When this timer gets also to zero, then the server will switch its state, either to active or will get the full scope in case it's not a standby relationship. So that was a quick look at the DHCP failover concepts. I hope you enjoyed it and I hope you understood what I wanted to explain. Stay tuned, because in the next video we are going to install a server core 2012, and in the next video we are going to configure that server core with DHCP and create failover relationships with DHCP 01. If you enjoyed the video, I would appreciate if you subscribe if you're not subscribed, and like and share it, and see you in the next one.